Thank you. This is really quite an event. When I walked into this auditorium, it just reminded me of so many good sleeps. This was a really good place to sleep, and I feel very comfortable here. I hope everybody, I don't mind if you don't stay awake, actually. It's one of the greatest things about internships is staying asleep. Thanks, Lee. Thank you. Well, as you heard, on June 30th, 1974, I walked out of, as Steve Bergman, MD, walked out of this hospital and immediately entered a psychiatric hospital called McLean. And this is the first time I've been back in almost 38 years, and I'm coming back, of course, as Samuel Shem, author of The House of God. And it's really wonderful to be back here. There are two joys as I was thinking about this, about being back. One is that this is the place that made me a doctor. You know, that one internship year in internal medicine, was remarkable in that you go from, you know, being scared to give somebody an aspirin to doing everything a doctor can do. And in my case, it helped me to sort of make a living in moonlighting in emergency rooms when I was doing psychiatry. The second joy about coming back here is, thank God I'm not on call. As you heard, I'm going to be talking about staying human in medicine, and I'll sort of lead you through where I've come from and to in my writing that you heard about. And the central piece, the central thing, is one thing that I've learned about staying human, and that is the danger of isolation and the healing power of good connection. Danger of isolation and the healing power of good connection. You know, as many of you know, when The House of God first came out, it was not welcomely and warmly received by everyone. It really, really was appreciated by my generation of doctors. But the generation before, and many generations before, didn't like it and didn't like me and spread some pretty bad rumors. And over the years, as you've heard, it's become, so to speak, kosher, right? But it's not always safe. A few years ago, I was at a potluck dinner that our daughter Katie's class was holding, just the parents, and I'm wandering around wondering if I could find somebody to talk to, and I see these two women sitting there talking. I get a little closer, turns out they're doctors. I get a little closer, turns out they're doctors from the Beth Israel, my alma mater. We have something in common. So I go up, sit down, wait for an opening, and I say, you know, I may not be the most popular, most favorite doctor at the Beth Israel Hospital. And one of them looks at me and she says, well, you can't be as bad as that guy that wrote that book. And there was this delicious moment, right? And I said, well, as a matter of fact, I am the guy that wrote that book. And she blushed a beet red, and that was the last play date our daughter had with her daughter. When I was asked to be the commencement speaker at Harvard Medical School 2 years ago, I wrote my pals, who were interns with me. And actually, there is one in the audience who was here in the internship year with me in 1973-74, Dr. Mark Stockman, a wonderful cardiologist who is not, he was such, he was such a good doctor and a nice guy that there was no way he could make it into the novel. So I told all the guys I was going to be the commencement speaker at Harvard Medical School. I immediately got back three emails. One said, well, we must really be in bad shape. We must really be in a depression. The second guy said, there must be some mistake. Are you sure it's not the commencement speech at the Harvard liquor store on Mass Ave? And the third guy said, this is the end of civilization as we know it. The House of God has had a very strange history. I never wanted to write a novel, but the year here was so intense and amazing and in some ways horrific that I figured somebody had to write about this, and it turned out to be me. I never thought of getting it published, actually, but I was looking for a play agent. And somebody said, oh, there's this agent in New York who's a play agent. So I wrote her a letter, said I've got plays. And at the bottom I said, P.S., I've got a piece of a novel. And she wrote back and she said, well, I don't do plays, but why don't you send me what you got of the novel? And the novel, I mean, it was, I didn't even know you were supposed to double space in those days, you know. And it was a typewriter. Remember, a lot of you have never heard of those things. But it was done on a typewriter, single spaced. It had, you know, cigar stains and liquor spilled all over it. And anyway, I sent it off. I forgot about it. And then 2 weeks later, I was in my first year of psych training at McLean. And I was in the secretary's office at McLean, this big psychiatric hospital. And the secretary picked up, oh, it's for you, it's so-and-so. And I had even forgotten her name. And I got on the phone, and this is the first feedback ever from the world about this crazy manuscript. She said, well, you know, I don't know if you're a madman or a genius, but I really like this book. Yeah. And I actually had the presence of mind to say, well, you know, I can't help you with that, but you should know I'm speaking to you from within the walls of a mental institution at this time. So it started out, and, you know, seven drafts later, it was a book. And I never would have expected what's happened with it. It's just astonishing. I took a pseudonym because I didn't want my psychiatric patients to know that I had written this sexy, funny, outrageous book. They all found out very quickly. And they came in and they said, what do you mean you wrote that sexy, funny, and outrageous book? How could you do that? You know, and that lasted about 10 seconds. And then it was, oh, you should have heard what my boyfriend said to me last night. Or, oh, my mother. They didn't care about me. They cared about themselves. I went just before it was being published. I went to the publisher and we had a little talk. And I said, you know, is this book going to sell? He said, no, it won't sell. And I said, well, why not? And he said, well, look, it's about doctors and that's good, and it's sexy and that's good, and it's funny and that's good. I said, well, why won't it sell? He said, because it's a good book. And so that was my introduction to publishing. Okay, what have I learned from looking back on the House of God? One of the things I've come to realize is everybody has what I call moments, where you see something, or you do something, or you don't do something, or you think you see something you should stop to do for somebody and you don't. You just keep walking, right? And you wonder, why did I say that? Why didn't I stop, etc. But every once in a while, there are so many of these, hey, wait a second moments that pile up that it gets me going as a writer. And that's what happened here in the Beth Israel. There were so many, hey, wait a second moments. That's not what I signed up for. That's what I started writing for. I realized much later that we interns then, and mind you, this was the number one hospital internal medicine program for the MATCH that year, so we weren't exactly chopped liver. We were products of the 60s. We grew up with the idea, based on our experience at college, that if we saw something that wasn't right or unjust, if we got together and took action, we could change things. During my college 4 years, we helped put the civil rights laws on the books, and we stopped the Vietnam War. So, when I came to medical school, and you know, Lena Adler's here, and Steve, you know, some of my friends, we naturally took resistance seriously. So in the spring of that year, when it was revealed that Nixon had been secretly bombing Cambodia in the Vietnam War, the whole country, you know, went up in flames. Everybody went on strike, and we in the freshman class at Harvard Medical School had to decide whether to go out on strike with the rest of Harvard. So we got into one of the big auditoriums and we called this meeting, you know, that was what it was like then. And people got, but we were just starting the kidney block, right? Just remember that? So people got up there and said, if we go out on strike, we'll never learn the kidney. And of course other people, I think us all included, said, the hell with the kidney, we're gone, you know. So we went out on strike. I never learned the kidney. Neither of these guys are kidney guys. And in the house, In the house of God, the kidney is a vaguely described organ somewhere between the back of the neck and the back of the knee, you know. Anyway, we entered, this is only in retrospect now, I realize it. We entered the internship with this set, this mindset of the cultural forces that had been driving us, right? You never know when you're making a decision. You think you're making a decision, but you're not aware of the cultural forces that are driving you to make that decision. So when we started to, we came into this hospital very idealistic. We didn't even take the bags, the doctor bags from the pharmaceutical companies. You know, very idealistic, wanting to really be good doctors. And we immediately came into what I call the conflict between the received wisdom of the system and the call of the human heart. And when we came up against that, and you can read The House of God as a novel of resistance to something that you don't think is right. When we came up against all of that, we just didn't go along with it. We stood up for what we thought was right. I want to read a couple of things from The House of God that were true. These things, it's hard to believe, but these things actually happen. There's a lot of sex in The House of God. Many of you are too young for it, I know. But, and it, apparently, wherever I go, people say it doesn't happen that way anymore. I couldn't believe it. My first night on call here, in my clinical training at Harvard Medical School, I did my first rotation here in surgery, right? And like the first night I was on call with my resident, you know, there are double bunks in these rooms, and we're getting ready to go. He said, "No, you don't sleep here." I said, "What do you mean I don't sleep here?" He said, "Get out of here. I don't want to see you till morning." So I got out, and I'm on my way out, and there's a nurse on the way in. You know, I was shocked. Okay. This is an example of, this is an example of how sex gets into everything in the House of God. This was Chief's Rounds with the Chief of Medicine. Chief's Rounds that day were introduced by the fish, the chief resident, and the patient was one Mo, a tough truck driver who'd had to wait in the freezing cold during the gas crisis to fill up his rig. He had a rare blood disease called cryoglobulinemia, where with cold, the blood clots in small vessels, and Mo's big toe had turned as cold and as white as a corpse on a slab in the morgue. "What a great case," cried the Lego, the chief. "Let me ask a few questions." And this is an example of this resistance I was talking about. We actually did this. To the first question, a real toughie, he asked Hooper. Hooper said, "I don't know." And so the Lego answered the toughie himself and gave a little lecture on it. To the next question, not a toughie, to Eddie, Eddie answered, "I don't know." The Lego gave him the benefit of the doubt and gave a little lecture, none of which was news to Eddie or to anybody else. The fish and the fat man were getting apprehensive about what we were doing, and the tension rose as the Lego turned to me and asked me an easy one than any klutz who read Time magazine could answer. I paused, knit my brow, and I said, "Sir, I just don't know." The Lego asked, "You say you don't know?" "No, sir, I don't, and I'm proud to say it." Startled and troubled, the Lego said, "In my day, the House of God was the kind of place where on Chief's Rounds, the intern would be embarrassed to say, 'I don't know.' What's going on?" "Well, sir, you see, the chief resident said he wanted the house to be the kind of place where we'd be proud to say, 'I don't know.' And damn it, chief, we are." "You are?" the fish said. "Well, never mind. Let's go see Mo." It's hard to believe this actually happened, even now. The chief fairly burned with the excitement of getting at Mo the toe's toe. And yet at Mo's bedside, for some strange reason, he went straight for Mo's liver, poodling around with it sensually. Finally, the Lego went for Mo the toe's toe, and no one was sure exactly what happened next. The toe was white and cold, and the Lego communicating with it as if it could tell him about all the great dead toes of the past, inspected it, palpated it, pushed it around, and then bending down, did something to it with his mouth. 8 of us watched. And there were to be 8 different opinions of what the Lego did with Mo's toe. Some said look, some said blow, some said suck. We watched, amazed, as the Lego straightened up and kind of absent-mindedly fondling the toe as if it were some newfound friend, asked Mo the toe how it felt. And Mo said, "Hey, not bad, buddy, but while you're at it, could you try the same thing a little higher up?" a lot of the stuff was about food. This really happened as well. This is the beginning of the year before we got into that stuff. It's an intern called the Runt. Another intern, the Runt, was having a hard time. As he sat down to lunch, he took out a pill box, put a pill on his hamburger, and munched it down. When I asked what it was, he said, Valium, vitamin V. I've never been so nervous in my life. Does the Valium help? Makes me feel kind of sleepy, but I feel pretty unflappable. I'm writing orders for it for all my patients. What? You're putting all of them on Valium too? Why not? He said. They're very nervous, having me as their doctor. After the others had left, the Runt said he had a confession to make. It's about my third admission last night. In the middle of all this trouble with the yellow man, this guy comes into emergency, and I couldn't handle it. I offered him $5 if he'd go home. He took it and left. One of the real joys of fiction, actually, is that you can take a situation that you behaved in a way that you're not proud of, and you can write it in a way to make it come out in a way you would be proud of. And that's true of this other thing I want to read you. The situation was, a patient of mine was a woman with metastatic breast cancer, and the surgeon took her down to the operating room and opened her up, and there was nothing they can do, so they just sewed her back up and brought her back up to the ward. And no one had told, when she came, you know, she was awake and everything, but no one had told her anything about what they'd found. And she was my patient, and you know, the nurse said, well, aren't you going to tell her what they found? The surgeons aren't going to do it. And I, to my shame now, I said, you know, it's not my patient, it's the private doctor has to do it, you know. And she said, well, then the private doctor's never going to do it. He's not going to come in tonight to do that. Somebody has to do it. And then the fat man character, that's as far as it went, you know, that, you know, the private doctor's not going to do it. And I went about my business. And I don't know who told her. But in fiction, what I wrote was that this character called the Fat Man offers to do it. And the narrator, Roy, describes the scene from the hallway. So this is all fiction. This is what I wished had happened. I watched the fat man enter her room and sit on the bed. The woman was 40. Thin and pale, she blended with the sheets. I pictured her spine x-rays riddled with cancer, a honeycomb of bone. If she moved too suddenly, she'd crack a vertebra, sever her spinal cord, paralyze herself. Her neck brace made her look more stoic than she was. In the midst of her waxy face, her eyes seemed immense. From the corridor, I watched her ask Fats her question, and then search him for his answer. When he spoke, her eyes pooled with tears. I saw the fat man's hand reach out and motherly envelop hers. I couldn't watch. Despairing, I went to bed. And then he goes off, he gets awake, and he goes sees a patient and comes back on the ward. I glanced into the room again. Fats was still there, playing cards, chatting. As I passed, something surprising happened in the game. A shout bubbled up, and both the players burst out laughing. So, what did I learn, looking back, what have I learned about the house of God and staying human? All the big academic hospitals are big hierarchies where somebody, they're called power over institutions, where somebody has power over you and you have power sometimes over somebody else. And what happens in those institutions is that the people lower down get isolated. And that's what happened. As you read The House of God, each of the interns get isolated from each other. Not only did we get isolated from each other, but each of us got isolated from our authentic experience of the system itself, right? We started to think that we're crazy for thinking this is crazy. And that isolation is dangerous. In the book, one of the interns kills himself, another goes crazy, et cetera. So the things that I, oh, and the only resistance to that, the only threat to a dominant group, which is at the top of this hierarchy usually, the only threat to a dominant group, if it's an unjust dominant group, is the quality of the connections among the subordinate group. The subordinate group can be subordinate by gender, by sexual preference, by ethnicity, by religion, by race, whatever. The only threat to the dominant group is the quality of the connections among the subordinate group. So that the first thing I tell medical students, especially about how to stay human, is stay connected. The quality of connection is what's important. And that's what we didn't do in the house of God. And that's true about everything. The quality of connection is important. Isolation is deadly and connection heals.